welcome you here to your house. And this is a day that you've made, a day we're going to rejoice and be glad in. We are excited about this morning. We're excited about the opportunity to come here and give you praise and honor and glory. To that end, we lift up our voices right now. Amen. Let's stand. Let's praise the Lord.
Call the sons of God, the whole manner of We spend a lot of time afraid of the valleys, fighting to protect ourselves from pain. Yet scriptures tell us to be grateful at all times. There is beauty in the everyday, the mundane, the here and the now. God is the God of the plains. He is looking over our everyday, our every choice. We would like to thank you.
When I look into your holy eyes, when I gaze into your loveliness, when all things that surround become shadows in the light of you. When I found the joy of reaching your heart, when my will becomes enthralled in your love, when all things that surround become shadows in the light of you, our worship. Thank you.
I'm 70 years old. I anticipate the time will come relatively soon, being a year or two, who knows, maybe shorter, maybe longer. I never thought I'd live to be 70, but I'm going to die sometime. And I'm going to tell you this morning this, and I believe this is true. It'll be interesting to see. I think when I face death, I will not be the slightest bit afraid. I think this because of some things that happened in my life. I almost died a couple times. One time was when I was younger and I had just become a Christian and was in love with the Lord and did something really stupid that you can do when you're young. I was racing a guy with my car. I had a Volkswagen Bug. Racing through the mountains near Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. And I hit a curb and the car spun and car went up on two wheels. Made a right turn. I'm going about 50 miles an hour, 50, 60 miles an hour. It makes a turn, starts heading for a wall of rock that was cut out that this road was cutting through. But luckily I was going, so the inertia going forward, instead of running into the wall, the car started flipping and tumbling. And it was just like you hear in the movies where things slow down. Here I am, I'm looking inside this car as it's making these continually bumps as it's rolling down the highway. My buddy who I was racing, he saw this in his rearview mirror, he was sure I was dead. But here I was falling, and there was be these bumps of hits, and I kept wondering when the bumps were going, I remember thinking to myself, maybe which one of these bumps is going to be the end? You know, and I watched Luke's luggage go out of the window and stuff. I was visiting somebody up there, and when it stopped, I remember feeling no fear whatsoever. I couldn't see out of one eye. It wasn't because my eye was lost, but blood had come out of a wound in my head and come down with such big amounts it covered my eyes. So I thought I was blind, but I was just thrilled. My buddy comes running back. He stops the car. He's coming running back. He's wondering whether I'm alive. Other cars were stopped around. They're all coming in there. As they approached the car, what they could hear was me singing. I remember I was singing, "Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder," you know, and I was okay. But I remember thinking about that. I said, "Why? I wasn't even afraid. I had just given my life to the Lord. I was so sure about Christ in me." And it took that fear away. About 10 years ago, I'm in a plane, high above. I think I was heading toward Florida or California, whatever it was from up here, whatever it was. And somewhere up there, up in the skies, I suddenly couldn't breathe. Couldn't catch my breath. And this had never happened to me before. I don't even think I ever told anybody about this, but I couldn't breathe. And I'm up in the air. I didn't think about calling anybody or pushing the button for anything or just panicking. I just sat there and was thinking, is this it? I was thinking, maybe this is it. Maybe I'm going to be having a heart attack now, and maybe I'm going to stop breathing, or something's happening to me, I'm going to die. And I just sat there waiting for a little bit. And then I could breathe again, you know. But I remember thinking to myself, well, is this it? Is this the end? And I remember not being afraid. Now, I think that's going to happen to me again. That's one of the things that happens. When you acquire a different mindset. I thought about it a lot this week because I looked on Facebook and I saw that, I remembered an event that happened in our church some few years back, where a young girl who knew the Lord took her own life. And you'd be crazy not to go, "Why, Lord? How could this happen?" You know, I was praying for her, you know. I knew she was gone, but I knew she was with the Lord. About a week before she had taken her own life, I had talked to her about her relationship with Christ. And, you know, she had assured me about her relationship and how she went to camp and found the Lord there and was trusting in Christ for her salvation. So I didn't have the same sense of loss I would have had if it was another situation. But still, you think to yourself, I thought about this with Orion. You know, we're praying for Orion. I'm praying for a miracle. I don't know what you guys were praying for. Orion was sick. I understand it looked bad. He was dying of cancer, and I'm praying for him, and I was hoping God would heal him. He's young. He was 21, I think. maybe less than that. Maybe you went through the same thing and you're asking, why, God? You know, or maybe we see a young person who's been crippled or hurt or some way, and we say, why, Lord? Why is this happening? But I've got to realize something, something I've come to realize, that one of the things that comes with what we've been talking about what happens when Jesus dies on the cross for our sins and the atonement process is taken care of, we're healed. It's what he came for the world with, not to condemn the world, but to save the world. The fact that Christ was risen from the dead and lives within us. God has a different perspective than we do. We have one that's natural for us. We think about this life as if it's everything, you know? We're afraid of death. We don't want to go. Some of us have jobs, like Don's job. You probably looked at death in the eye a few times in your life, right? Don used to try to hurt me. He put the fear of death in me a little bit. Right there. I want to read a story. Did you see the cover of the bulletin? Everybody get a bulletin? For most of you, at least in twos. You know, a few others out, Mark. There are storms that come up in our lives. I want us to think about it. And we learn from the fact that we've got a risen Christ. Anybody trying to miss one of these stories? Look at the picture in the front. There's nothing written there that you're going to like. Look at the picture in the front. I think you'd be scared if you were on that boat. Yeah, I think I'd probably be scared. About 4 years ago, we went through the Gospel of Mark in here in church. I remember in the fourth chapter. It's in two of the Gospels, too, but there's that story about that ship you see there on the Sea of Galilee. It's early in Christ's ministry here in the fourth chapter of the Gospel of Mark. You all know the story, but I'm not sure you remember what Jesus said to the disciples when this happens. This, brothers and sisters, is the word of God. So he has just called the disciples. They've been around him a little bit. Jesus has healed a few people. Crippled man, who's in the synagogue and healed the guy with the withered hand in the Gospel of Mark earlier than this. There was someone who had leprosy and he asked Jesus to heal him, and there was healing there too. So Jesus had shown some power. But the disciples, as you know, they didn't always pick up on everything, and they still haven't by this time. And here in the fourth chapter of Mark, Jesus has been teaching. They've been along watching him teach. And he's been spending a lot of time doing that. And they come to the point where Jesus wants to relax a little bit. And, you know, there are storms that come up in our lives that we are responsible for. Even as Christians, sometimes we have storms that come up that where we face very difficult and tough times or dangerous situations. Because even though we love the Lord, we listen to the world sometimes and we make mistakes and make bad choices. We get ourselves in trouble. I'm dealing with a couple of people right now that have just had very difficult lives, facing storms that they're very fearful of. They're fearful for their lives. Then there are storms that we're not responsible for. They just happen. Sometimes because we're along with someone who gets us into trouble. You know, we're not responsible for the storm, but we're there with them, and we're along with it. And that happens sometimes too. And so it's not necessarily our fault, but we're right there too. Then there's some storms that nobody's responsible for except maybe God. And then God does that sometimes. He brings storms into your life for a purpose and for a reason. And I think that's what happens in this story. This from Mark chapter 4, reading verse 35 and following. And you know the story, but listen carefully. That day when evening came, he said to his disciples, let's go over to the other side. This is the other side of the Sea of Galilee. And the Sea of Galilee, you know, fishing out there, you know, it can be pretty dangerous. But they're on their way, and as you know, some of the disciples were fishermen, and they knew what they were doing, and they get in the boats. Several boats were going along during this particular event. And as they took off, leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was in the boat. There were also other boats with him. A furious squall came up, a storm. And you get a picture, if you look at that picture on the front of your cover, you realize these storms can be pretty bad. And this one was. And the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. Boat gets swamped, boat goes under. You're in the middle of the Sea of Galilee, you die. Jesus was in the stern. I get this business about being in the stern. Stern is the back of the boat, right? And there's a really cushy pads that they had right back there. This is, you can just see it now. They're with Jesus. Jesus is the master. He's the master teacher. They're the followers of Jesus now. They're his disciples. But now they're getting in the boat. They're going out in the Sea of Galilee. And, you know, Jesus was a carpenter. I mean, they're not building the boat. They're riding in the boat. And you know, if Joel was along, he'd be doing the same thing. Just relax, Jesus, like Joel does to me. Get to the safe place of the boat where you're not going to be out of my way and not going to cause any problem. And I know the experience. I'm the youngest of a family of six. Mom, dad, four brothers. Art's the oldest, by the way. He's not younger than me, as some people think. He's 6 years older than me. My other two brothers are older than me, too. And we used to go to a place in New Jersey called Parvin Park. We'd go to Parvin Park, and we would be a beautiful little place where we'd camp and set the tent up, and we'd stay there for several days, and we would go and we'd rent canoes. And canoes, it sounds like it's fun, because they had a beautiful lake there, and the lake had a lot of passageways you could go back in, and it was like you were in the Amazon River, it seemed, you know. You'd go back there. There were snakes we saw on trees at times. It was an unbelievable experience, but it wasn't as much fun for me. Why? Because I was Johnny. I'm little Johnny. You know, my brother Art was a Boy Scout, a good Boy Scout. Dave was a Boy Scout. George was 2 years older than me. Now, one canoe was my dad, George, and my mom. They didn't want to make my mom have to paddle. But the fun parts about being in a canoe is you want to be the guy in the back there. That's where my dad was, big, strong guy. And you'd steer the boat where it goes. You decided where this canoe went, and you paddled. And the other part that was fun might have been in the front there. You're paddling too, so you're making this thing go. Me, I sat in the middle of the canoe with my brother Art and my brother Dave in front. And I'd be in the middle, and I didn't even have a seat to sit on. They sat up on a seat there. They were higher and would bend down there. I'm sitting down here, little Johnny sitting down there in the middle of the canoe doing nothing. My big event was, you know, I'd be sitting in there, and I would take my hand and put it over the side of the canoe. Put my fingertips into the water. That was the big thrill for me. The only time I got it set away, one time Art intentionally tipped the boat over, and that was exciting. But here's Jesus, and you know, they're fishermen. They said, "We got this one, Jordan." So the Lord goes, and he's sleeping. The squall comes. And suddenly it gets worse and worse. It probably didn't bother Jesus at first, and Jesus is sleeping through the whole thing. He appears to be sleeping through the whole event there. And the waves are picking up, and the boat is getting swamped with water, and they're all getting wet, and they're afraid for their lives. Jesus was in the stern sleeping on a cushion. But then, when it got bad, the disciples woke him up and said to him, "Teacher! Don't you care if we drown?" They're afraid. They're afraid of dying. They're concerned. They're shaking Jesus. "Get up. Hey, teacher, we need you now." I can see Jesus waking up. Oh, you sailors need me in the water here, you know. But he got up and rebuked the wind and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." And the wind died down, and it was completely And Jesus turns to the disciples and he says, "Why are you so afraid?" His point was, don't you know who you're with? Why are you so afraid? He's teaching him something that's going to stay with him for a while. "Do you still have no faith?" he says. Well, they were terrified. They were terrified because they couldn't believe that they were with a man who calmed the waters by saying, "Be still." You know what happened when Jesus was arrested, taken? John was at the crucifixion. Nobody else was. Where are the other disciples? This is after being with Jesus for 3 years, having him watched even heal people, save people, and raise people from the dead. But as Jesus gets arrested and going to that illegal trial and he's going to be crucified, the disciples, they're scared. They're afraid. The Gospel of Mark tells us that after he dies, and he dies on the cross, their dreams are shot. They don't remember anything. They're not picking things up. They don't remember what Jesus taught them. Instead, they're afraid for their lives. They've locked themselves in an upper room for fear that the Jews were going to come and get them and kill them. That's what they were afraid of. Fear. I'm suggesting to you that because Jesus died on the cross for our sins and was raised from the dead, we should start acquiring the same type of mindset that God has. You know, in the book of James, it talks about our life here on earth. We think this life is everything. Our biggest fear is dying. We're concerned about it. If somebody's sick or hurting. That is not God's biggest concern. That's what I need to understand about Orion. I wanted God to heal Orion. Orion loved the Lord. But God took him home. And that's okay. We want to say, well, look what all Orion missed in his life. No, he's missing nothing. He's just graduating. I got to hear a woman speak when I was in college. Her name was Corrie Ten Boom. You know who Corrie Ten Boom is? Only one of you know who Corrie Ten Boom is? Yeah, a couple of you know. Amazing. Remind me to show the Hiding Place movie. It's a great movie, and the book was fantastic, too. Corrie Ten Boom was in a concentration camp. Very tough situation, near death all the time, in a German concentration camp in World War II. And the story is really, if you read the Hiding Place, it's all about her sister. Her sister was this amazing girl named Betsy. Betsy had what we'd call a lot of storms in her life. When she was young, she was very sick. She was anemic. And it turns out that she could not, Anyway, so, but Betsy was a super spiritual girl. As sick as she was, she couldn't have a baby because of the anemia and the damage it caused her and the sickness she had when she was young. So she never decided to marry. Even though she was a beautiful girl, she wouldn't marry. And eventually, there she is. She's caught up in this. She's always ministering, caring for people, taking care of people. She's the older sister. And Corrie Ten Boom just loves her older sister, Betsy. You know, she is the model. You know, there's a story in there, in the book there, where they're in the concentration camp. And there's this female officer, Nazi officer, who was beating a woman. You know, the women were separated by them. And these two girls were standing on the side there, young girls, in the concentration camp in 1944, and they're naked, and they're right real close by, and this Nazi woman is just beating this woman as hard as she can. And Corrie Ten Boom says, "Oh, that poor woman." And Betsy goes, "Yeah. I'll pray that the Lord forgives her." And Corrie Ten Boom goes, I was talking about the woman getting beat. But she realized Betsy's mindset was she was feeling bad and praying for the Nazi who was doing the beating. That's the way she was. Well, she had a dream that she was going to be released from prison this 1 year. And she told this dream about how she was going to get released, and she was. She was released because she died. And I remember Corrie Ten Boom, and I heard her speak in person. I was as close to her as I am to you, and watching her, and this amazing woman told this story. And she talked about her sister, and at first she was going, Why her, Lord? What do you think? She's a superstar for you. Somebody came up to her who had shipped to the front and said, yeah, exactly. She's been promoted. And what a way to think, she's been promoted. You know? I think of the girl that took her life here. I don't know what she was going to face in the future, but maybe God knew, and whatever it was, she took her life. But I know she loved the Lord. I know she's okay. I knew she was okay. I talked to her. I knew about a relationship with the Lord, and that helped tremendously. And I thought, her father wrote something in the Facebook this week and put a picture there and had a very nice saying. And I wrote back and I said, just think, as I spoke to him, I said, just think every day we're closer to seeing her. Because that's the reality for us as Christians. What does James say about our life here on earth? James in chapter 4. Starting at verse 13, this is the word of God. Here's James when he writes about this. Now listen, you who say tomorrow, today or tomorrow we will go and do this or that in the city, spend a year there, carry on business and make money. That's what we think. We're making plans. We're always thinking to himself. He says, why, you do not even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. A mist of vapor, puff of smoke. Our life here on earth is that small. That's his point. He says, instead of thinking the way you guys are thinking, you want to have a different mindset. Instead, you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast and brag, and all such boasting is evil. Anyone then who knows the good he ought to do and doesn't do it sins. Once we're a Christian, we ought to have that mindset like Jesus got. This is not it. This is a puff. This is a time. It's an important time to us. I'm not trying to deny that. But one of the keys to understanding and grasping and understanding the life that we're called to live and to live for him and to stand up and represent him is one where we understand that this life isn't it. There are bigger things than this life. And that's God's perspective. Is that a good answer to tell somebody when someone young dies or something? No, I don't know. I don't know if I understand it either. But it does help me to know that this is not it. Christ came to save the world for eternity. Paul had that. We talk about an abundant life. What was Paul's abundant life? He becomes a Christian and everything gets bad. He used to be respected, liked, went around persecuting, hating the Jews. He becomes a Christian, he meets Christ on the road to Damascus, his life changes. I'll tell you how his life changes. Everybody hates him. That was his life. If you read through it, you read through the book of Acts, everybody hates him. If you look in the 11th chapter of 2 Corinthians, he talks about the things he's gone through. Took in the 40 lashes, minus one. That means whipped until you're about dead. 40 lashes was supposed to kill you, so they'd give you the 39 lashes. They'd whip you till you're nearly dead. Got beaten by rods 3 times. Been in 3 shipwrecks, and he's got another one coming up. The worst one. I mean, his life is nothing but storms. He's got groups of people whose mission in life is to kill him. They swore they won't rest until they kill the Apostle Paul. That's what happened toward the end of his life. This was his life, in prison all the time. Now, he could look around and he could say, look what God did to Peter. Peter got in jail. He'd send angels in there and they'd... Chains would fall off them, shackles would fall off them, they'd walk open, open up the locked door, they'd walk by the guards, and he'd be out there preaching again. Don't think Paul probably said a few times, Hey, why don't I get that deal? No, I don't think so. Paul had that, what can this world do to me effect? That's what he thought. For me to live as Christ, to die, that's only going to be better. And if we lived the life that Paul had and experienced as he had, we'd probably think that same way too. Put up on the screen. You know, I talked to you a couple of weeks ago about a verse that was very important. I said Hebrews 10:8. That's the one where Jesus says, where the writer of Hebrews says that Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He doesn't change. That's why we talked about the fact, because Christ doesn't change. His purpose doesn't change. He's still got the same purpose, only we're carrying it out now. This is what we're supposed to do. But a few verses before that, this is verses 5 and 6. That was verse 8. Keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have. Because God has said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. And to me, this addresses that life that we're supposed to seek. The world's got its own way of understanding what an abundant life is going to be. Our life is going to be different than that. Our life is going to be serving the Lord Jesus Christ. That's going to be the joy. That's going to be the factor that brings us the life that we want. You know? But if all you're doing is trying to be successful and to make money and to have things and whatever it is, you're going to miss out, because those things will leave you empty at the end. They will. They will disappoint you. They will not satisfy you. The greatest joy you'll have in your life is when you're used by the Lord for His work and you see people's lives change because they encounter the risen Christ in their own lives. And they get changed. And that's the thrill that's unbelievable. He says, here's what you're resting. God's never going to leave you. He's never going to forsake you. So we say with confidence, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can man do to me? What can man do to you? Nothing. What can this world do to you? Nothing. You can face storms and meet storms. And you'll be able to handle it. And you can face them fearlessly. If you let your relationship with the Lord grow and you understand, I'm Him. I'm waking up in the morning, I'm saying, Lord, how can you use me? What can you do with me? How can I serve you? Who can I reach today? That should be the most important thing in our lives. That's what's going to bring you the joy that comes with the abundant life. And you don't have to worry about anything. That's taking on responsibilities God never intended you to have. He says, I got you. I'll take care of you. I'm watching your back. And even if it comes to the point where you're facing death and indeed and you die, that's the point. What can this world do to me? Take my life? No, it can't. My life's eternal. I'm going to live forever. Are you following this? Because I've got a big story that I can tell next week. It'll take about 15 minutes. Next week?
Next week.
Next week. It is a great, great story from Acts 27. About a storm, and you want to see how God uses a storm. It's just a nightmare for everybody. It's a nightmare for everybody involved until the end. We see how God works and does things and uses things. But I want us to acquire that same type of attitude that the Apostle Paul had that will help you in your life. What can this world do to me? What do they think they can do to me? Do I fear the world? No. Do I think some bad choices are being made by our leadership? Yeah, I do. So what? My real leader, the Lord Jesus Christ, I know exactly what He wants me to do, and it's not going to change no matter who's in charge, whether it's the Republicans or the Democrats, whether it's Trump or whether it's Biden. I'm not saying I don't care about those things a little bit, but it's not the big deal. My life is controlled by what I'm going to do for the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the president I want to listen to. He's the one I want to know and I want to follow. And there is no greater life than you will have in this life than being in His service and being used by Him. And that'll be true whether you face storms or whether you don't. How great to be fearless and bold because Christ lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know who holds the future. And life is worth the living just because he lives. That's that song we've been singing the last couple of weeks. So I'm going to come back and start here next week and continue this talk here. And I want to talk to you about this stuff because I want to tell you, we don't have to be afraid of storms at all. We can embrace storms. We can embrace tough times. We've got a Lord who thinks differently. He's got an eternal future. This is a year where our good friend Gar lost the love of his life, Joe, a wonderful Christian woman. But he can go on because he knows that every day that goes by, he's one day closer to seeing her again, her beautiful face, because she's with the Lord. All right, I'll stop here. Pray with me. Lord, this is just the start of this talk here, Father. I want to get into what we do when we face storms and how we can use these things for your glory. Bring them back next week, Lord, so I can finish this story for them, this sermon talk. Lord, thank you for your perspective. Thank you that you came to save the world, not to condemn it. I thank you for the way you love children, and you have them in your arms. Amen. We're going to have communion right now. And we do it a little differently. We're going to continue for a little while longer, doing it the way we've been doing it. The elements, the bread and the cup, have been prepared very carefully with gloves and not touched by human hands, whatever it was, so we don't have to worry during this pandemic time. We don't have to worry about that. And so we don't hand it out to everybody. We'll have you, if you want to partake, and this is the Lord's Supper, not ours. So if you love the Lord, and you care about the Lord, or you're trusting in Christ for your salvation, and you want to participate in this communion service, you'll come forward, come and take the elements and bring them back to the seat yourself, as we've done in the past here. And if you don't come, that's okay. If you don't love the Lord, don't worry about it. No one's watching, no one's making any judgments whatsoever. If you're too young and you don't understand what it's all about, don't partake. It's okay. Let me read to you from 2 Corinthians, 1 Corinthians, chapter 11. Paul received this from the Lord. This is the same things that he said at the Lord's Supper when he was betrayed on that day, and that Thursday 2,000 years ago. But he received from the Lord what he's passing on to you. And Paul writes this in 11:23. He says, "For I received from the Lord what I passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me.' For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again," and he's coming. So what we're going to do is we will sit quietly, pray, check your hearts. If you feel you want to participate in the Lord's Supper, you come forward, you take the elements, and bring it back to your seat. care of it. Bread is a symbol of our Lord's body that was broken for you and for me. In the same way, the cup is a symbol of the Lord's blood that was shed for you and for me. Now may the God of peace, who brought up from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you perfect in all goodness that you might do his will. And may he make of us what he would have us be through Christ Jesus, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. You're dismissed. We do have some refreshments upstairs if you'd like to come up, and we'd love to have you up there.